My name is Hans-Jürgen Walter, and I'm the Global Sustainable Finance Leader at Deloitte. It's my pleasure to welcome you to today's webinar on the pivotal topic of corporate sustainability reporting, strategic integration of double materiality. Thank you for joining us. Before we continue, please note that this webinar is being recorded. A link to the recording will be shared with everyone who registered after the event. We have come together today, not only as professionals, I think, but also as concerned global citizens to delve into a concept that is reshaping the landscape of both financial and non-financial reporting. This concept is playing a key role in driving actions across financial services during the sustainability transition. At Deloitte, we partner with businesses worldwide to navigate and manage the complex interactions between ESG factors, financial performance, and business strategy. Double materiality is a concept that goes beyond traditional boundaries of financial reporting to include the impact of a company on the planet and society. Today's discussion, ladies and gentlemen, will not be limited to a technical analysis of financial reporting requirements, although they are indeed important. Instead, our panel will explore the practical implications of double materiality assessments, the benefits of integrating double materiality into corporate strategy, and the steps to implement this approach effectively. I'm very pleased to welcome Rebeca, Susanna, and Wim to our discussion today. Welcome you as well. These distinguished experts will share their insights from their extensive experience in integrating all these practices. It's important to note that not all corporate sustainability reporting frameworks use double materiality. However, as our discussion is elaborating, the insights we discuss today apply more generally. As we proceed, I encourage all of you to actively participate. So we will have some polling questions during the presentation, and we also invite you to post questions via the Q&A function that you can see at the bottom of your screen. I think all of you know this Q&A function. I will now hand over to Simon to set the stage for our discussion. Simon leads Deloitte's Sustainability Regulation Hub in EMEA. So I hand over to you, Simon.
Thanks very much, Hans-Jürgen, and hello everyone. Very pleased to join the webinar today. So Hans-Jürgen mentioned polling questions, and we've got three quick questions to kick things off to gauge who's in the audience and to help our panelists tailor their remarks. So could we have the first question, please? Thanks. Thank you. So first off, it'd be interesting to say, which sector or industry does your organization predominantly operate in? So if you could vote quickly. We've targeted today's webinar at financial services, but obviously the principles we're going to talk about are kind of part of CSRD, which applies across all industries. And I think similarly, although CSRD itself will apply across all industries within the financial services sector, but certainly given the phased implementation of the requirements, we've seen, or I've certainly seen, some of the larger banks and insurers amongst the earlier adopters. But that doesn't mean that other firms can't try and get ahead of the curve and start thinking about this. So if we could just see the results, hopefully people have had time to vote. Great, thanks. So a lot from banking, but quite a good mix across insurance and investment management and some other sectors. So everyone's welcome. And as I say, I think what we'll talk about certainly applies more generally. Can we have the second question, please? So great. So just in terms of geography, could you let us know where you're based in the European Union? In Europe and the UK, but not the EU, Middle East and Africa, the Americas, Asia Pacific, or somewhere else, although I'm not sure what we've left in terms of venues. Obviously, CSRD is a piece of EU regulation, and I'd expect a lot of people on the call to be kind of based in the EU, but it's also clear that for internationally active firms headquartered outside of the EU, CSRD is still a key piece of regulation for their EU operations, especially where they've got large revenues or subsidiaries in the EU. So can we just see the answers as well, please? Great, thanks. Yep, so two-thirds, 70% in the EU, but a mix of other people. Obviously, the time zone doesn't work particularly well for Asia Pacific, but we will, as Hans-Jürgen said, we're recording the webinar and we'll make it available afterwards. And just quickly onto the final question. So we're interested in your role or function. So are you a chief sustainability officer or part of the sustainability function? A CFO or part of the finance function? The CRO or the CCO or part of the risk compliance function? Or do you have a strategy or a board role? I think this is, CSRD has kind of had an interesting journey, at least in my experience, often dropping in an organization, especially 18 months, 2 years ago, maybe to the sustainability function as another piece of sustainability regulation, but very quickly being picked up by the finance function, often and led by the CFO. But then once you start to implement CSRD and you think about how you're going to bring the data together and plumb it through the organization, it's critical to get risk strategy and the business involved. So thanks. Great. Thanks, David. Okay, so a really interesting mix. So a third of people from the sustainability function or CSO, and then a mix of risk, compliance, and finance, and a lot of other. So unfortunately, can't unpick that too much, but really interesting to see people from other other functions. Okay, so as the WIM and the panelists just quickly digest that information to think about how they can tailor their thoughts, let me just make a couple of remarks by way of introduction. So as you'll know, I think everyone will know, Corporate Sustainability Reporting Directive, CSRD, adopts the principle of double materiality. That's obviously in contrast to the international standards and other standards, so ISSB, for example, which cover only financial materiality. But then the GRI standard looks at impact materiality. So although CSRD stands out as having double materiality at its core, it's not unique in that there are other combinations of standards that give you that financial materiality and impact materiality focus. And the starting point for our discussion today is the double materiality assessment. So a company under CSRD, a company must specify how it impacts the environment and society on the one hand, so the impact of materiality, and how sustainability risks and opportunities affect the company financially on the other hand, so the financial materiality assessment. The ESRS, the European Sustainability Reporting Standards, provide guidance to firms on how to do that materiality assessment. And then more recently, EFRAG has produced its implementation guidance. So there's a lot of information on how out there to help firms get started in this. And I think for the purpose of today's discussion, the key point I want to pull out from all that guidance, and there are hundreds of pages of it, is that the assessment should consider the actual or potential significant impact over the short, medium, and long term, and both upstream and downstream in the value chain. So we've got a piece of reporting requirements, but it's looking at the business now and in the future, near and future risks, and all across the value chain. It's pulling together a lot of information about how sustainability is impacting or might impact the business. And as companies consider the materiality assessment, they need to consider which topics are they going to disclose, which stakeholders do they need to engage with to do that assessment, how are they going to score impact, risk, and opportunity. And as you bring all that together, I think it starts for me to be obvious as to why we are bringing together thinking about that materiality assessment and then corporate strategy. One of the concepts I just want to mention, though, is dynamic materiality. So a concept popularized by the World Economic Forum a few years ago, and something that I think the panelists might touch on in their comments. So it's perhaps obvious from what I've said that the materiality assessment is not a point in time static assessment. It potentially evolves over time. For example, what's financially immaterial today may not be in future. And that materiality assessment might change because of the external environment, how the market evolves more generally, or maybe because of the actions of investors or other stakeholders. So that materiality assessment kind of is really quite a complex thing. And I think the the final point I want to make, and which really kind of tees up where we want to take the conversation now. CSRD is a reporting requirement, ISSB and others similarly. But really what policymakers are achieving through these reporting requirements is forcing companies to do all the plumbing, to collect the data, to put in place the governance that transforms the company to be able to understand and manage its sustainability risk. So the outcome is important, that disclosure is important, but all that investment is going on. And there's the potential to then leverage that investment in data, in processes, in technology, to change the way that within your company you manage sustainability. And the starting point for that, I think, is to think about the interaction between sustainability and strategy. And so given the nature of the double materiality assessment, given the perspectives it's looking at, we think one of the starting points is to think about the interaction between sustainability and strategy. And so with that, hopefully that sets the scene. I'm really pleased to hand over to Wim. I'll leave him to introduce himself and the panel. Wim, over to you.
Thank you so much, Simon. Thank you for that introduction. Thank you all for joining this discussion today with the three of us that you see on screen: Rebeca Coriat, Sandra Schoonhoven, and myself. So maybe as I speak to introduce myself briefly. I'm a sustainability partner with Deloitte, focusing for a long time on disclosures and related assurance in the times when everything was still voluntary. But nowadays, as we are discussing, and Simon, as you introduced, we are in this era of double materiality and mandatory disclosure frameworks in the EU, being the CSRD, and underneath the European Sustainability Reporting Standards, the ESRS. And I am on the board of EFRAC, the Sustainability Reporting Board, that advises on these ESRS and also provide further guidance. So maybe to get you aware of that to the extent you are, and we have just released further guidance on double materiality and how to go about that in light of also all the comments that you might, Simon, on the decisions that companies have to take and what they have to consider, including importantly for the financial industry, the wider value chain. And we will for sure be discussing that. I would like to introduce the two other panelists. Now, I should say that Sandra has a technical issue, so she is about to join. But in the meantime, I will introduce both of you, and hopefully Sandra will indeed join in the next minute or so. But Rebeca, you already come on screen. Thank you very much for joining, and very interested into your insights today. You are the head of stewardship at Lombard, Odier, and as I learned, for more than 10 years, focusing on advising institutional investors on how they should go about sustainability and corporate governance matters. And maybe in light of today's discussion, it's of particular interest that you're also on the board of GRI, the Global Sustainability Standards Board, the GSSB. I'm very glad, by the way, to hear about that, because having been involved with the GRI, I know that they were always short of people from the investors' background and environment. So very pleased to see that you are on that board. Sandra, who will join in a minute, as said, she is working at ING. She is the global COE lead for sustainable expertise at the bank. She is with the bank for a long time, for more than 10 years now, in sustainability, before that in other roles. She is experienced in ESG sustainability topics such as climate, but also in reporting. And from both of them, we will hear today further on their perspectives on three things. I think, Simon, you already introduced how to approach double materiality and what are some of the interpretations that both of you have taken. Then secondly, and as important, what does it mean for corporate strategy now or in future? And then finally, how to put this all into practice. So these three topics we will cover in the next 35, 40 minutes or so. And we'll aim to make it a conversation. So maybe sometimes you'll hear me sharing also some insights that I either have from AFRAC or from wider experience. With that, I think we start with the first bit. And Rebeca, whilst Sandra is not there yet, and I would have started with you anyway, because also of your role at GRI, I would be interested, first of all, in your perspectives on DMA, on double materiality analysis. Does it add to the overall picture? Does it add to sustainability? How do you view that?
Yes, of course. Thank you very much. And hi, everyone. Thank you for joining this webinar. Before we go into answering that question, I just had two comments from the poll just now. One is something that caught my eye, the wide variety of functions that are represented here. I've noted now that there's only 4% of board members. So let's keep that in mind, because that's one of the points I wanted to make. But equally, I think it's very positive that there's a diversity of functions represented. And that is one of the key challenges and opportunities that we see with dual materiality. The fact that we need to really connect the dots across the different teams in organizations. And then the other comment I also wanted to make before we go into the question is the concept of the paradigm shift that I think we're dealing with when we talk about dual materiality and the tsunami of sustainability reporting that is coming our way. And I think it has been very well expressed just earlier how we are really trying to turn the SOC inside out and think about things. Yes, the disclosure, the outcomes is the end product, but that end product is also allowing us to change this strategy and to change how we think about the strategy differently. So in terms of dual materiality analysis, some considerations to begin with, and maybe get some questions as well from the audience. I think what is key to a good materiality assessment is to make sure that all the stakeholders groups are included, number one, and number two, that sustainability topics are correctly weighted. And number three, probably the most important one, that enough time is set aside for internal discussion. I cannot emphasize this last point enough, because once the material topics have been defined, and for financial institutions, there won't be too many surprises. Senior management and board members, they really need to understand the process and they need to understand the results. This takes time. So reporters in the room will need to take time to educate, to train. They have to push back on their pushbacks and maybe even some handholding for this process. So that was one first consideration.
Why would you say, if I may, that it's so important for the board members also in particular to understand the process? If I would challenge this, I would say, well, they need to understand the outcomes and they will recognize, because they are all topics that they are mostly familiar with. So how do you see the relevance, if you like?
Well, I see the relevance in the process, because with dual materiality, we're looking at strategy and topics on a horizontal, but also on a vertical way. And even if the board members have the skills and the knowledge, and sometimes that is not always the case, that boards are adequately staffed, they will need to supervise the process as well. They will need to sign off on the dual materiality reports. And why would a board member sign something off where you have had very little oversight and participation in controlling the process? That would be my answer and my suggestion.
And of course, I was asking the question, but I have some perspectives myself. I have seen that that in a number of cases, indeed, we sometimes call it overestimate the board's understanding, right? So you think they understand because they oversee the whole company, but then when you really start digging into the topics, it appears to be a little different, and even the concept of double materiality, so impacts on the one side, as well as risks and opportunities on the other side, seems to be a little more complex, if you like, than it may seem at first sight. So I definitely relate to your comment, Rebeca. I see in the meantime that Sandra has joined. So Sandra, welcome, and I'll come to you in a second. If you can please also come on camera, then we'll further the discussion between the three of us. But Rebeca, you also said you need to engage all stakeholders. It's very relevant to all stakeholders. So now that can be interpreted in many ways. You can say, many, right, in terms of number. You can also say, particularly also all the external stakeholders, and including, call it, all the NGOs. How would you see that? How would you go about that?
Yeah, yes, of course. So I think the emphasis should be less on the numbers than on the sort of the source of the stakeholders you engage with and the categories they sort of belong to. So clients is a very important stakeholder to engage with. You also have to engage with your employees to see what they think. I think that is very important. There's a need to engage, as you say, with civil society. For a significant amount of these matters, they will have very strong and passionate views about what needs to happen. And even if the institution does not end up including them, it works a little bit like a sounding board, or even sometimes a red flag. And there's also the engagement that needs to happen with sort of public entities who are in charge of regulation, this regulation that is coming our way, and having that open and ongoing conversation with them, we think is crucial.
Right. Okay, Sandra, good afternoon, and thank you for joining. I already introduced you, so I hope everyone knows, if you like, who you are and where you're working on. Very glad that you joined, because I know you have a long-standing experience in reporting and wider sustainability as well. So we started this discussion off with how do you approach it and how do you interpret it, and Rebeca just shared a few first considerations. Maybe for your organization, ING, and knowing that you are long time, of course, in sustainability and related reporting, you may have gone through the DMA process by now. I hope you have. Can you share a little on how you have gone about it, and maybe also where it is different to what you had done to date, so to say, in under the GRI process?
Yes, of course, and thanks for being patient with me. I had some technical issues to join after a few years of Zoom, and you should not have this anymore, but unfortunately I did. No, indeed, we have quite some experience already over, I think, a decade of integrated reporting using GRI to also report on sustainability and other non-financial impacts. So you could imagine that, or you could ask the question, is it still a big step now to move to CSRD and from GRI impacts materiality to double materiality? And on the one hand, it is not, in the sense that the thinking is the same, but in really following up on all the reporting requirements and how to really perform this to, I would say, more to the letter than into the spirit, which was a little bit more the case with integrated reporting and GRI, that is quite different. Also, if I look at the number of stakeholders internally involved, so it used to be mostly sustainability as a department, and then of course working with the business and also finance. Now there's quite a lot more stakeholders involved as well. And I think when it comes to the double materiality, what is key for us is to, yes, listen to stakeholders, but first and foremost, make up our own minds what is material to us. And really see this as a data-driven exercise where we look at, okay, in our own value chain, what are the specific parts in that value chain that are important to us? Now, obviously, as a bank and mostly a lending bank, that's the lending we provide to our clients, whether that are private individuals, big corporates, or SMEs. And then we also assessed, okay, what does that mean to our own operations? And then per value chain, really assess all the ESRS topics and subtopics. When does something become material, whether it is in terms of exposure, whether it is because of reputational opportunities or risks, and really assess that based on numbers, data we have, public sources that are available, so that we make it as objective as possible. And only when we have that picture, we now are in the process of also socializing or engaging with stakeholders on that to get their views on it, to assess, did we miss something? Are we overseeing something? Are we making something too material or not immaterial enough? Mm. Are there topics outside the ESRS that we miss? But especially also, because it's always quite easy to have a view on what actual situation is, but how does that move to, let's say, longer term? Because that's also very relevant to look not only at what there is now, but also medium and long term. How will it change over time? But for us, it's crucial that data-driven and more objective status is first established, and then we move on. And to your question, is it different? Yeah, I think the main difference is the financial materiality, which is, of course, not new to us. Doing a risk materiality is not new to us, not even in the ESG space. And the opportunity side, I think, yeah, not very well described yet in the ESRSs, but we all have a picture of what that can look like. So some elements the same, but definitely, yeah, if you ask me what is key here is not to go too quickly to your stakeholders to ask, but first make up your own mind.
Yeah, that is a very, very interesting comment, because I think, as you said, traditionally, if you like, we were kind of used to go out to stakeholders first, ask what they think is relevant, and then say, like, ah, what do we think, and then filter it, if you like. And you say effectively, well, we turn it around. We first look at what we think matters to us potentially, or we already think it does, and then we go out to stakeholders. That may be reflecting a little, because in EFREC, at the Sustainability Reporting Board, we also had quite some discussion on engaging stakeholders. And the standards in itself say that you need to take regard of the interest and the impacts on stakeholders, but it don't says like you need to consult with them. And in the past, we have seen that that many, many stakeholders were consulted. Also, the question that I raised to you, Rebeca, but now there may be more focus on, let's say, and I don't know whether you did in the past, but let's say more, how should I call it, like informed interactions than surveys, for example. How do I see you, Rebeca, already nodding? How do you see that? Is that the way to go? And maybe Sandra, you first, because it builds on your comment on first knowing yourself and then going out to stakeholders, but also then Rebeca, interested how you see it.
No, I think you translated exactly what I meant. Indeed, very informed moving to stakeholders, mm-hmm. And I think they are crucial to make sure that you're not focused too much on what you think yourself or you've. Yeah, I mean, we all know that sources are there, but yeah, do they tell the full picture? So I think really to complete your picture and to maybe validate or confirm that you're right, that's where what I think is super important to still talk to stakeholders, and especially also stuff that is not yet in all those sources. So more the forward looking, and your stakeholders will be able to tell you if you are overseeing that. But other than that,
will you then be very selective, if you like, on your stakeholders? So not just ask all and everyone and all and everything, but really ask one stakeholder on a specific topic that he or she is really knowledgeable about, so to say?
Yes, that's the idea for sure. So be quite selective in the number of stakeholders, but have a very good spread in type of stakeholders, and then be focused on, for example, we have a large retail customers, retail-based customers. Yeah, I'm not going to ask my retail customers, what do you think we need to do, let's say, in our own operations? Really focus it on what matters to them and have them to input on that, and for others to do the same, but then for other parts of the value chain.
Right, right. Yeah, so you're heavily nodding, Rebeca, when we started to talk about this. What are your further perspectives?
Of course, no. So some further ideas there. I think it's important to have clarity on the process for that assessment. I really think it should be topic selection first, then stakeholder selection, then assessment, then analysis, and then the validation of results. So of course, your team, you know your company best. So you should be the one choosing the topics. And we can talk about that a little bit later. Once you've come to your sort of wish list of topics, that's when you sort of cross-check them with selected stakeholders. It's like, you know, a bit of a health check, sense check that you are on the right path given your business and your strategy. But it shouldn't, I agree, the starting point should not be the stakeholder selection. Mm-hmm. And then another comment on the sort of this going from surveys to more sort of conversations, touch points, I think that is very useful. Surveys have been very useful and they can add a lot of value. But generally speaking, you can get more understanding, more detail on these conversations, on a narrative exchange rather than on a multiple choice selection. And that is what we see in surveys. Because when you give a multiple choice to your stakeholder, you have already made a selection about what they can or cannot say. So in a way, you're already limiting how they're going to input into your process. Yeah. And, you know, there's statistical reasons why that is done. But I think the narrative approach is also very important.
Yeah, the very, very, very good comment of the narrative approach. I like that. Maybe one point also to dig a little more into, and also, Rebeca, they're interested in your in initial views as also advising to institutional investors, is that aspect of value chain. For all of you, we discussed it early this week at AFRAC again, the financial institutions standards. And I must say, unfortunate, but it will take some time before they are there. It will take definitely another 1.5 year before we will be having first draft. So just that everyone is aware, which means that you as financial sector will not have specific guidance on how far you should go. Then we issued the value chain guidance last week, and also there, if you look into it, it gives some direction, but it doesn't tell you, like, particularly not for financial institutions, you should go downstream tier 1, 2, or 3, or you should not go downstream at all. It stays a little guiding, as it is. So maybe Rebeca, maybe first your perspective, also working with many institutional big investors, what would you advise them? How far should they go? And we all know about financed emissions, but then it is, of course, about water, biodiversity, human rights, and all that. And then, okay, so hopefully you have the answer for us here today.
Yes. Yes, I do. No, I'm afraid I don't, but we all are trying to solve this question. I think a few ideas. One is the confirmation that we are just not focusing on climate. We move to continue to consider climate, but move away also to other wider aspects such as biodiversity, nature, pollution, etc. And these are in themselves even bigger than climate. Mm-hmm. So that's for a bit of a relative context. Then regarding the how can financial institutions ride this wave when there's no definite guide for the sector. So one comment would be that, how to say, it's we're all learning together. It's a learning process. It really is a learning journey for financial institutions. And I think those counterparties who read your reports and who try to understand them will be aware of that. My sort of stewardship job, this is probably the most frequent comment that we make to companies when we engage with them. Your sustainability journey, we are aware this is a journey and it's dynamic, it is evolving. So it goes back to, in a way, that dynamic concept that you were referring to earlier. It's not, we're not looking at a photo finish product. It will change every year. And I think the wider community is aware of that, of how things move. And then the other point that I would also address is that even though we don't have those standards, we have many other standards. And these standards overlap a little bit or a lot between each other. So if financial institutions can already have clarity on their reporting under each of their standards, and I will mention them, some of them now, I think that will go a long way towards being a bit more ready when in a year and a half or two there is guidance and parameters for the financial sector. And it's also, you know, we try we try and then we get it wrong and then we try again. So it's also that awareness that I think is very, very important. Some of the, before I give the floor back to you, just I'm sure all of you will know these names, but some of the names I will highlight is, of course, the GRI, the GRI standards, you know, the oldest, cover all topics and allow you to highlight that the impact that you're having. Principles for Sustainable Insurance, PRI principles, of course, UN Global Compact, Sustainability Accounting Standards, Board Framework, SDGs, CDP questionnaire, TCFD, TNFD. If you're able as an organization to have a concise and precise view of each of them, that will put you already in a sort of advanced position for what's coming next. And I appreciate that's a very difficult job.
Yeah,
which requires a lot of manpower.
Exactly, and you need quite a few frameworks. Of course, institutions as other companies are really looking for that simplification, if you like, and harmonization. So we're on a path there also with the TCFD that is now part of the IFRS Foundation, the ISSB, and working together very closely with GRI as from 2 weeks ago, really formally confirmed. So I think we're getting into a better place with connecting impacts and risks and opportunities also to each other. And there, Sandra, I think it would also be interested to hear from you when looking into further integration into the organization, right? So having looked at your value chain and the impacts as well as risk opportunities. And then, you know, I know that you are still in the process. Rebeca said earlier on, but there comes also an element of really engaging the board, really sometimes even educating them. But that then also comes with what we are also particularly here for, which is, and what does it mean or what should it mean for strategy? What would it mean for risk management, for looking quite different, if you like, at your portfolio? How do you see that evolving maybe at ING? Is it already, or is that really to be started? How would you reflect on that?
No, very good good question indeed. For ING, sustainability has been one of the core pillars of our corporate strategy already for the past two and a half years. So it's very embedded and it's top of mind. It's also already been part of the way we report our dedicated publications, where we also use all the frameworks that were just mentioned, the climate report, a nature publication, our human rights report, and then bringing some of that content also back in our annual reporting, using again some of the frameworks that were mentioned. So it's the topic itself and all the aspects, whether that is the risk side, the opportunity side, how do we make an impact with our clients, they're all being discussed in different layers in the organization. So when it comes to the opportunity side, of course, what are these next opportunities? What kind of commitments can we make? Take, for example, our commitment to triple renewable energy finance, which we did in December last year. Of course, that is firmly embedded in how we want to steer our business. So that's with our business colleagues as well. But also on the risk side, especially for financials, all the guidance, and I would say maybe a little bit more stricter than just guidance from ECB, EBA on that front, has already made that a very firm part in the way we do our risk management processes. So there's nothing new in terms of embedding that in the organization, that is already happening. CSRD is not going to change that. I think CSD is going to help us to be transparent on that and to be there, to be comparable with other banks on how we actually do that, and probably force us to report on that in a certain way. And therefore, these frameworks that we've also used for, let's say, our climate publication have been very helpful to structurize the information in a certain way that we know our stakeholders want to see, and not just our own narrative or story, but really to make sure that we cover all the elements. And I think that's also where CSRD is going to help us. What is not helping us is that indeed sector specific guidance is not there yet. So I am looking at a few disclosure requirements that are not very helpful for a financial institution. So what to do with it? Or quite restrictive disclosure requirements that make a lot of sense for a producing company, for example, but not so much if you report on those producing companies as a financial institution. So I think the lack of sector specific guidance is definitely not helping. In terms of putting this very firmly into our strategy, I don't really think this is key, but it is helping as well. I mean, yeah.
And at the same time, and interestingly, you said it is also helping you, let's say, elsewhere in the organization, and maybe even more in the front line, if you like, not only for the strategy and the board. So the embedding may be much wider and deeper than only strategic considerations. And still, I wonder, would you see also in light of the value chain discussion that we had, and Rebeca, I think you said it will further develop over time. You said it in different words, but I think this was the direction. Would you see, Sandra, this still creating further embedding, further understanding, better insights also for steering the business, and thus should you use it for that purpose? Or would you say, well, it helps us, but this is primarily reporting what we do already. So, don't try to make it another loop.
No, I think it helps. I mean, just also very practically, you need a strong project team to make this work. Usually, I think in most organizations, you will have some sort of governance and a project team to work on this. And in that project team, I think we see now other actors than the traditional actors when we were doing integrated reporting, for example. So participants like indeed from the risk side, but also from the business side, are a lot more active in this project than they were ever before in integrated reporting. They were then more a contributor at the end stage, but now they're a creator as well. And they are being asked to deliver many, many elements like data, for example. So I think that is really helping to put it even higher on the agenda. Makes it also more challenging, I would say, but definitely helping to put it even firmer at the heart. And that's what we're aiming for.
Right. Okay. Maybe I'll come back to that in a second. But Rebeca, maybe talking about integration from your perspective and you working with institutional investors and asset management. What do you see as the value of this information for decision making, if any, of course, right? Would you say like, well, our role as Lombard OJ will be strengthened, will be helped by this. We will use it to provide better advice, not only on the impacts but also on the risk opportunities, or to say like, well, we take it mainly as compliance, so to say, right, to see where a company is. How do you see this going forward, and maybe not only next year but also, you know, the years ahead?
So it starts with compliance, but it's much more than compliance, and my view and advice would be to really consider it as going significantly beyond compliance, because when you change that mindset, you're able to see the opportunities that arise from that. Let's just look at an example. For example, biodiversity, the protection of nature. What policies and processes do any of the financial institutions here today have in place? And that we know that from the regulation and the future standards, we will have to increasingly allocate more capital to that area. How are we going to do that in a way that addresses the financial materiality and the sustainability materiality? So if we can already start to think about the governance on that, the investment process, maybe a portfolio exclusion based on biodiversity considerations or portfolio limitation of percentages, speaking with other sort of peers, and I don't want to use the word stakeholders, but collaborating on this to understand what our peers are doing and how we can put that in place in a global way. Risk managers, are my risk managers able to assess and give a rating to biodiversity risks? If not, why not? And what do I need to do for that to happen ASAP? And does my board know that this is not taking place and the company? So, and if not, why not? And what needs to happen? So it's just from every question, from every topic, it allowed double materiality. I think it allows us to really connect many dots together. So I would say it's not just a compliance exercise. We respect compliance a lot. It's a very difficult job, but I think we need to see it as going beyond and changing what we were saying at the beginning, the way we think. It's a bit of a paradigm shift.
Should you act, you think, ultimately as a financial institution, if a company that you invest in or that you finance ultimately does not integrate it into strategy? Should you say like, well, you use the word exclusion, but can also think of other conditions, but should that have these consequences, you believe?
I think that is always an option, excluding or divesting within sort of the stewardship toolkit that we can use. But I also think that is an option that should really be the last resort, because if a concerned institution like Lombard Odier is invested in that company, we will be spending time trying to shift it, to convince it to do A instead of Z. And I think, you know, when you divest, maybe your own portfolio is cleaner, but the real economy is not. You're just giving that issue to a less concerned actor. So it's a partial yes. It's yes and no. And I really think it should be on a case-by-case basis, every divestment or exclusion decision.
Yeah. Well, and I think you earlier said on the journey, right? We should give it some time, or maybe in general. I also know colleagues from the real economy side that companies who work on this for a long time still have some work to do, some homework to do, particularly on value chain, but also on data collection for their material topics. Although we all thought like they are already doing that in a good way. If we go too strict too soon, then we might lose also the ultimate objective. But what would you say, Sandra? Would you say going forward, not for ING itself, but for all your clients, you would see it influence your decision making, if you like, also from a risk perspective?
Yeah, I fully much occur what was already being said, that in the end, it's the last resort to really divest. But it is actually an opportunity to engage, because we're all in this together. So indeed, our clients also need to do their reporting. And if we both feel a certain topic is material, then how do we get the right data to be included in these reports that make sense for all actors in that in the ecosystem, so to say? So I think it is really important that we are having those conversations and see what can be done instead of indeed just using the stick and we will disengage or divest if you are not acting. And we also know that it is super hard still to the topic that was just mentioned, biodiversity and all the different layers of what we need to report on. The data is just not available in many cases. So we also need to provide some time to move into the area of really collecting correct and relevant data, and then make sure that we have the right choices. And hopefully this is going to be a huge change, where we have not just the CO2 emissions. I mean, that's it's still complex, but it's the easy part, right? But to really be able to collect the data on all the other E elements that are part of the ESRS, but definitely also the social. And we are usually forgetting about the social element. I also even see that when we discuss the DMA, usually the main focus also in conversations we have is all on the E. But the S is even harder to get the right data on and really understand where those impacts are and also where the risks and opportunities are. So there's still a long way to go, and we should actually provide ourselves a bit more time to adjust to that situation.
Right. And would you say, because we did not focus so much on that, but on the financial side, on the risk and opportunities, of course you are used to risk management and models, etc. But when we look here at these topics that we discuss about, social topics, biodiversity, even climate, by the way, do you see the value in really quantifying those risks and opportunities, or how do you look at that? How do you see that, you both?
I really see the value of quantifying it, definitely, because it helps you to understand a topic from a very different angle and to really see, if we are not acting now, what kind of risks will cause that in the near future. And I think it's a bit like any human nature, right? You usually discount anything that can happen in the future over what you need to do now. So and I think therefore it's so important to see those risks, how it will increase over time, whether that is, for example, a transition risk or a physical risk. And are we making the right choices now that are going to have an impact, a positive or less negative impact in the future? And providing loans can be a very long-term engagement, right? So providing a mortgage will last for 30 years. 30 years from now, we're beyond 2050. We should be net zero. Yeah. So any choices that we make now do have an impact for a long time.
Exactly. Yeah. Rebeca, you agree?
Completely agree.
Okay. Good. Maybe also in light of the time, let me end this conversation with the last final question and with a short answer or reflection from both of you, which is. All of this is meant, it was said in the beginning also by Simon, not to report for the sake of reporting. It's reporting for the sake of change. And the financial sector is seen as critical for this. Now, we will have double materiality. We will have the material topics, etc. Do you believe that that the financial sector is really being the sector to move the needle here, to make it the system work as the EU intends? I know it's a hard and high level question, but what is your initial like thought on this?
I'll go first. Let's see what happens. The answer will be more of a no than a yes. This sector has a responsibility for allocating money and making it possible to invest, but that's not the whole responsibility. Should not be on this on the financial industry.
Nice. Yeah, that's a nice answer. And you, Sandra?
Yeah, very, very similar view. This change cannot be done just by the financial sector. So we need everyone to contribute. And sometimes it's really coming from us as a push for the financial sector. Sometimes we really need more policies or governmental actions in place. Sometimes we really need our clients to act and create more awareness. So I tend to think about this as a sort of a triangle where these three main actors need to come together, and only then it will work. But we are definitely one of those critical actors.
Right. And I see on screen that we have a number of supporters with hand claps and thumbs up. So thank you for that last reflection. I realize we have much more to discuss, and I see a number of questions that unfortunately we were not able to answer in this conversation. But I think you have both shared some great insights. And with that, I would like to thank you very much for that and hand back to you, Simon, maybe for some final wrap up and maybe some final reflection. So to you again, and Rebeca and Sandra, thanks again.
Thanks very much, Ruben. And let me extend my thanks as well to you and to Sandra and Rebeca. That was a really interesting discussion. And I think, notwithstanding, we could have discussed more, I think covered a lot of ground. I like Rebecca's phrase about turning the stock inside out. That's much better than the way I've described how to go from the reporting requirement to the transformation. So many more points to pick out, but I think we ended on a really good note, and Sandra's triangle analogy. I think this question about what is the role of the financial sector is getting asked a lot at the moment. And I think it's to describe FS as one of those three kind of points, along with companies and governments, I think is a really constructive way to put it. Rather, not take all the responsibility, but also not try and push it all away. So this is definitely a conversation that we can continue. I think we've covered a lot of ground now. We've recorded the webinar. We'll make that available and circulate the link, hopefully early next week. So if you have colleagues who weren't able to join us this morning or you want to re-listen, please do. If you have follow-up questions, please feel to reach out to myself, to Wim or Hans-Jürgen, or to one of your existing points of contact with Deloitte in your local geography. When we send the webinar out next week, we'll also make sure that there are the points of contact there. And we'd welcome any feedback on the discussion today or on what other topics you'd like us to talk about in future. Finally, I think there are many different pieces of information floating around. I think one of the key things as we go on this CSRD journey is to keep in touch with the new developments. So on screen now, you'll see a QR code you can use to sign up to a newsletter that we publish monthly on regulatory developments and sustainability. And within that, trying to embed both what those key developments are, but also signpost some of the key pieces of thought leadership and eminence coming out of the sustainability and climate team within Deloitte. But with that, we'll end there. Thank you again to Rebeca, to Sandra, to Wim and Hans-Jürgen, and I wish you all a good rest of the day. Thank you.